Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of MACHTAILS from the Cantina Live. This is the impromptu episode that I do sporadically during the weekday. Tonight, I'm going to call this Music Monday. This show is inspired by a Patreon member of mine, Antonio from New Jersey. Antonio asks, what's the one band that you wish you would have seen dead or living? Mine was Jimi Hendrix, but I'll get to that later on. Another question that he asked that really sparked my imagination and turned this into an episode that has become a little bit of consuming because I felt like I was doing a research paper getting ready for today, and I really just want to have a drink and a chat on Music Monday, you know? But he asked Ginger Baker or John Bonham. Now, we're going to get to that sooner than later. I got help behind the scenes today. My friend, Tyler Page. Tyler, why don't you come out behind the curtain, man? And I want to thank you for your support and your help tonight. Now, you're a paid patron member, and this is not part of your perk. Do you feel like you're getting your money's worth with the content? Is it too much? Is it not enough? I feel like I'm ready to take my clothes off and do an OnlyFans segment if my does not grow at this point. So how do you feel about the content you're getting on MACHTAILS from the Cantina?
Oh, it's overwhelming. I mean, you just load up things randomly. I just get barraged by content. So it's a lot to handle. But, you know, what I like about it is it's 20 or 30 minute pieces and I can just pop one on. It's not a formal long form kind of thing that a lot of podcasts do. So that's why I like your content. I like to support. So
so you feel like you're getting your money's worth.
Oh, yeah.
That is a positive. Yes, I'd like to hear that, man. Well, hey, thank you so much. Now, I also want to say too that this show is inspired by my next guest. He is coming up on the YouTube episode for March. That's a freebie that we've been putting out since last April. Mr. Billy Mack, Billy, welcome to the show, man. Welcome back to the show. Now, I recorded the session with you for the March episode, that was supposed to be your debut. No, we're debuting you live, man.
I know, sweet. I'm still waiting. I mean, when did we do that other show? Months ago.
No, it wasn't that long. It feels like months ago.
It's too long to edit, man. What are you, Stanley Kubrick? I mean, geez.
A lot of people do compliment me on my editing, and I take that to heart because it takes so much time, and I feel like I'm so underpaid for that service. But yes, I'm editing it down. And you know, you've kind of inspired this episode as well, because when we chatted briefly about music and when we were done, you said, hey man, let's talk about music next time. Yeah. And I said, well, hey, why don't we do a Music Monday live show, you know? So thank you for that inspiration. Now, you, like me, you're a big music fan. What have you been listening to this week?
Oh, you kind of cut out there a little bit, Chris. What have I been listening to this week?
Yes.
Well, interestingly enough, I love music. I'm primarily a fan of older music. I was a fan of older music when I was younger. And I'm still always finding stuff that I never turned on to. And this past week, I have been listening a lot to Peter Gabriel era Genesis, which I was completely unfamiliar with.
You weren't familiar with that at all.
Other than Lamb Lies Down on Broadway, I knew nothing about that era. A lot of people have recommended it to me because I like prog rock, I guess. I mean, there's definitely some prog bands that I'm really into, like Rush and ELP and stuff. And yeah. So I saw a film of them once, just, you know, like 5 minutes, and I don't know, it didn't do much for me. And then I just, I don't know, going around YouTube, I came across this guy who had a recommended, you know, set list, and I started listening to those songs, and it just, all of a sudden, that door opened. So
Yeah. Well, you know what?
Sometimes what happens, it just gets you at the right moment, and Yeah, so I've been really enjoying that. That's what I've been listening to this week. What else have I been listening to? Oh, Blue Chair?
Yeah, Blue Chair. Poster right there.
Yeah, well, that, yeah, and coincidentally enough, yeah, I've been listening to some of them. And I've been a fan of theirs for ages. But some of their later stuff has shown up on iTunes, you know, a few things that I've never heard before. And
you know, so what? I feel like the Blue Chair stuff, it's, you know, they were a huge part of the San Francisco movement. But I feel like a lot of that stuff is kind of like the MC5. Like, it's kind of just so good, but it's underrated and undiscovered, you know? What I've been listening to this week, I've been listening to, because we want to talk about John Bonham and Ginger Baker, I took a deep dive into Ginger Baker's mass diverse catalog. And I went down a rabbit hole, as they say. And I'm still listening to a lot of traditional jazz music. That's my fall, winter. We're just getting into spring now, obviously. But I listen to a lot of traditional jazz, which to me is just timeless. XM Radio, Real Jazz, XM 67 is one of the stations that I listen to. So now I want to talk to you about the first, man. First record you ever bought on your own.
Oh, wow. Well, the formats at the time when I first started buying music was 8-track and LP pretty much. What was the first? I'm pretty sure the first one I bought was Yesterday and Today by the Beatles on 8-track. I also remember saving up for the double live Kenny Loggins album, but that was a little bit later, and I had that on vinyl. I think I still have it, actually. But the Yesterday and Today 8-track, I think that must have been, I was probably buying 45s before then, though.
Did you say Kenny Loggins? Did I hear that right?
Kenny Loggins, yeah. Kenny Loggins, no. Live.
Now, I gotta tell you, man, that's another underscore.
I don't know. You know what? Now, the more I think about that, that came out in 1980. So I know that was later. Because I also remember another early purchase was, they put out a box set. It was on vinyl. And it was ELO. It was like 4 or 5 of their albums. I want to say it was like in 77 or 78. So I had like New World Record, Out of the Blue. I think Discovery was on there. That was like the latest album. And I remember saving up my allowance to get that. I don't know what happened to that. I don't have it anymore. But,
well, you know, Kenny Loggins, another, again, that guy was making some really kick-ass music in the 60s and early 70s, Loggins and Messina. That was like almost Grateful Dead jammy type stuff. You know, I don't know if you've discovered that yet, but, you know, that's what I love about music too, is that there's stuff that came out moons ago and we're still discovering it today. I think that old music is still fresh in that regard, you know? And the music today is just kind of horrible, in my 60s opinion.
'60s and '70s were just an incredible era for music. And the older I get, the more I realize that. I don't think there's anything that's come after that compares to it.
No, I don't think at all. A lot of the stuff that I listen to nowadays are like the underground stoner rock bands. They're the bands that are so inspired, and they're trying to throw back to the early 70s sound, like Cactus and Vanilla Fudge and Mountain and those kind of bands. Now, what was the first record that I bought? I talked about this on MACHTAILS, was Iron Maiden's Wasted Year. Iron Maiden's Somewhere in Time. It was the video Wasted Years that really, really sold me. Now, we both play music. I literally have played everything from death metal to drums in church to psychedelic jam rock in between. Do you feel like your music is that diverse as well?
I do, yeah, because I grew up, our household, it was kind of interesting because my dad is from Oak Park. My mother's from Mississippi, like northern Mississippi. So, and they both love music. So, even though they didn't play instruments, there was a lot of music in the house growing up. So some of the earliest music that I listened to was my dad's 45, his 45s, which was like Elvis, Fats Domino, Bill Haley. My mother loved Elvis. Of course, she grew up, you know, in the 50s in that area where Elvis was from, and even knew, you know, some people that he went to school with in Memphis and everything. And of course, and she loved country. So there was that influence. And me and my brother, that we listened to that music, and then we got into the Beatles, and then and Wings, who were, you know, at the time were very big in the 70s. And then in the 80s, you know, as guitar driven music started to kind of fade, we got into metal, and I became a big metal head. I still love heavy metal. And but I love music from the 70s, probably because I was a little kid. I just idealize it. It's, you know, I love pretty much all of it. I think the only thing that I draw the line at is like the Village People. But
big supporters of Steve Dahl's Disco Demolition at White Sox Park. I know you guys are big White Sox fans, and they probably blew up so many Village People records on the field at White Sox Park. You know, it's funny because my parents sound like they were born just a couple years after your parents were. My mom and my dad were into really cool music. You know, I've mentioned numerous times my dad was buried with the Dark Side of the Moon album. My they missed the 60s movement, but they were like, they were weird. They were kind of like post-hippie, like early 70s stuff, like Genesis, Pink Floyd, Jethro Tull, Big Yes fans. And my favorite music, somehow, as you can see, I'm surrounded by my Fillmore poster collection. I for some reason, I got drawn into the late 60s music. And my parents didn't raise me on that stuff. I love 70s music, but there's something about the 1960s music and what Bill Graham did to the music business, you know, for the music business, I should say, was just such an inspirational on the path that I chose for my career that unfortunately I'm no longer in. But, you know, speaking about music, speaking about concerts, what was your first concert that you went to?
Robert Plant. It was in 85. I went with my brother. I was 13, and I was a huge Zeppelin fan. And it was kind of disappointing because, it was my first concert. So, you know, I wasn't disappointed. I was very easy to impress. You know, Plant was very good, but he didn't play any Zeppelin. That was at a period where he wasn't doing any Zeppelin at all. He was doing this side project called the Honey Drippers, which took up a section of his show. That was my first show. I had to wait for him to actually play Led Zeppelin songs. And then I think the next one I saw after that was AC/DC and Yngwie Malmsteen opening up, which was also 85. So that's kind of where I was, you know, that's kind of where I was at that time.
I feel like your show, you know, it's funny. I saw Robert Plant and Jimmy Page in, I don't know, what was that, 94, 95. I'm sure you were, as a Zeppelin fan, you had to have been disappointed to get the Honey Drippers set.
Well, I think I wasn't expecting anything else, really. I mean, at the time there was no internet, but this was kind of known that he wasn't doing Zeppelin. But rumors start flying, and it's like, well, maybe he will, you know. And late in the show, he started doing that "Keep It Cool, Baby," that part from and the place went crazy, and then he just stopped. You know, it was like it was just a tease. So, but I wasn't really expecting him to do Zeppelin. It was pretty much known that he wasn't doing it, but I had my fingers crossed that maybe he would do.
He would.
We had to wait for that.
Yeah. You know, it's funny you say you saw Yngwie Malmsteen. I guess you could say I saw somebody that's in that genre. The first concert that I saw, my mom took me to, I was 15 years old. It was Joe Satriani. I saw him at the Aragon Ballroom. That was my first show. So hey, you know what? We are still in March, which means Women's History Month. And there's some really important ladies that really shaped the music industry. Back in the day, a lot of people were inspired by these people. By women of the 1960s, that I should say. Aretha Franklin is one of them, but I got to go. My favorite is Grace Slick from the Jefferson Airplane. She is just, I love her attitude. I love her edge. And I feel like the thing about Grace is her vocal range. She would scream, but she would mellow out like when she did Ladder. And to me, she would just drop dead gorgeous. And I think, you know, over the years, you know, drugs and alcohol took a toll on not all the musicians, but I think Grace lost her beauty just from partying too much. She actually got fired. She fired herself from the Jefferson Starship because she had too many wild, drunken nights. And she went to Germany and she put on a Hitler costume. She dressed up as Hitler to mock him. And she really pissed off the fans in the audience. I mean, she ended up making some bad decisions. She almost dosed President Nixon with LSD. Her and Abby Hoffman showed up at the gates of the White House. They actually got in to the White House. And years later, the police showed up at her house and, you know, she greets them with a gun. She greets them with a gun. So again, attitude, beauty, and the vocal range, I think she just really inspired so many women after her, including the Wilson sisters, you know?
Hey Chris, you're a big Muppets fan. Are you familiar with the vocals you did at Sesame Street?
Yes, yeah. Grace did, you know, not only did Grace do the Sesame Street stuff, she also did Levi's Jeans commercial, and she did some work with Frank Zappa. And the Frank Zappa stuff, the B-sides, were released on the Jefferson Airplane box set. But I mean, again, you know, I think that's a lot of diversity. You work with Frank Zappa, you work on Sesame Street, you're doing commercials. Not only are you singing for the Jefferson Airplane, but you did something terrible with your career. You were in Starship. And a lot of, to have a Star Wars twist on this, I would have to say that the reason why she was not in the Star Wars Holiday Special was because she fired herself from the band. Now, here's the question. What would Grace have said about doing the Star Wars Holiday Special? I don't know. You know, I think it would be okay for her because I feel like it went up to... it fits in with everything else that she did. So, but you know, I want to tell you my introduction to the ladies of rock, definitely the Wilson sisters. But when I was young, when I was a young metalhead, my room was not covered, but I had a lot of Lita Ford pinups.
are you a Runaways fan?
You know what? I like the Runaways. I can't consider myself a fan, but she was drop-dead gorgeous. And I think that I've always had a thing for the blonde ladies. And I think when I saw this chick doing her videos with the sexy clothes on, with the cool guitars, she had the Beastie Warlock guitar, I was just mesmerized. I was mesmerized. Now, I do want to, before I pass it off over to you and get your take, you're on your favorite woman in history, I want to give a shout out and raise my glass to somebody that not only led protests in Washington, D.C. with Bob Dylan. And I got to tell you, man, there were no musicians last year leading any protests of any kind. Not that I know of. She's been arrested for this. Joan Baez, she performed pregnant at Woodstock in the rain at 1 a.m. And she was also on The Muppet Show. This girl would go Alec Guinness on me because I feel like she's got a very, very long list of achievements. But I know The Muppet Show, Woodstock, and protesting. So I feel like she would be like, dude, do you know what else I've done? But anyways, and I love the fact that here's another cool bit about Joan Baez. She wrote a song that Judas Priest had covered. Diamonds and Rust. But I gotta tell you that the original version, her original version that came out in 1975, I love Priest, but Joan Baez's original version is just 10 times heavier because of the emotion that song gives off alone. So I can't say that I'm a huge fan of her music. I know that she's done a lot of great stuff. I'm not really a folk music guy, but I respect her career. I respect her career, and I respect whatever she's done that I'm aware of. I've been blown away by it. So maybe I need to take a dive down the rabbit hole on the Joan Baez catalog. But how about you? When it comes to the ladies, where do you stand with your favorite woman?
Well, there really are tons. But the question was, ladies in rock, right? I mean, there's some tremendous country singers. There's a whole slew of soul singers that I can say. But I just, you know, I whittled down the list, Chris, and I could not eliminate, and this may seem obvious, but this young lady right here.
Oh, yes.
There's no way, I can't get past it. I mean, to me, she's the one I love the most. She's the most powerful. She's, you know, I think that, you know, that's why she's been unsurpassed in rock, is because she just was a powerhouse. You know, there was that blues element, there was a country element. You know, again, here's another person out of this San Francisco scene. I mean, she lived very hard, but she was from Texas. There was just so much pathos in the way that she sang. And, you know, it would have been really interesting to see what she would have done in the 70s had she lived, because she was, you know, she started out with Big Brother, this San Francisco psychedelic band.
Oh, yeah. You know, there's a lot of Big Brother
album.
Posters in this room right now.
There she is right there in the back. Great picture.
This Big Brother album too, this was called, it had a very crazy title, like Sex, Drugs, and Rock and Roll. That was the original name of the record.
They just put out a CD with a lot of outtakes and stuff, you know, that's titled that. Have you seen that? It's a 2-CD set.
You know what? No, I have not. I know that they've released a lot of Big Brother on Amazon. My favorite song from that record is Sweet Mary. How about yours?
Combination of the two. And Summertime. I had when I was a teenager.
I'm delighted that Janis Joplin is back.
She was doing more soul oriented stuff, and she was a big Tina Turner fan. But I think my introduction to her was when I was, I don't know, seventh or eighth grade or something like that, I picked up a really old VHS copy of Monterey Pop. And that movie opens up, which is one of the first concert movies, by the way, 1967. And it opens up with the credit sequence is combination of the two, which yes. She doesn't even sing lead vocal on it. But her background vocal is so incredible. You know, what she's known for from that concert is Ball and Chain, which they, you know, they actually have footage of in the movie. And I mean, it's an amazing performance. And while she's performing, they show Mama Cass Elliott from the Mamas and the Papas sitting in the front row, just like, you know, with her jaw dropping and completely amazed at what she was watching. You know, nobody sounds like Janis. I've heard people try to imitate her. I just, and there's something about her. It's, I don't know if it's the right word, but there's a muscular quality to her voice that I think is probably very influential on even male singers like Robert Plant. You know, I mean, I could see her like heading a Led Zeppelin type band. You know, it's like she had that type of raw power, and there was nothing fake about it. You know, it wasn't put on. I mean, this was exactly how she sounded.
Yeah, I think she, you know, definitely was her own demise. She had a lot of depression. She was self-medicated heavily, which is weird, right? Because there were a lot more psychedelic drugs being used, like just pot and LSD. But while people were tripping, like Grace Slick was probably doing acid, Janis Joplin, she was drinking a fifth of Jack Daniels, you know?
That's what I understand, that she was, you know, Southern Comfort was her drink of choice, and she drank a lot, and she became very good. She was very good friends. Well, they were kind of an item, actually. She was involved with Pigpen from the Grateful Dead, who also, you know, died very young, and I think died at 27 or something. You know, this 27 club thing. But he, Pigpen also was, you know, even despite being a member of the Grateful Dead, was not a drug user. He liked to drink. And him and Janis were very tight. You know, like I say, they were an item. They were beyond just tight. And, you know, they both burned out very young. And they were both blues aficionados. I mean, yes. Pigpen was basically a scholar. His father was a, you know, Pigpen from the Grateful Dead. His father was a DJ, and they had introduced him to the history of blues. And I mean, he was really deeply involved in that. And Janis, I think, came from the same school. You know, I think she was into like Laverne Baker and her contemporary Tina Turner. I know she was a big fan of hers. You know, so there was that soul influence. There was that kind of country, you know, her voice.
But Bobby McGee, you know, I know Kris Kristofferson, I believe he wrote that song, country singer. She covered that. You know, little fact.
Oh, there's a Grateful Dead too. There's a close tie in there. It's too bad that they didn't, you know, continue. I always wonder what, I think Janis seemed to be going in a soul type of direction. And God knows the 70s were filled with so many great female soul singers, you know, everybody from, you know, Chaka Khan to the Honeycone or whoever. But she was, you know, she left Big Brother and was her new band, although she kept Sam Andrew, who was the guitar player for Big Brother.
Yeah, Sam Andrew, yeah, she kept Sam.
He stuck around. I don't know if he's on the last album, Pearl. I'm not sure. Do you know if
he's he was. But the funny thing about Sam Andrew, I always thought that, you know, because Big Brother, they went on without Janis Joplin. And of course it was never the same without her. They never had any. It was kind of like the Doors went on for two albums after, a lot of people don't know that, after Jim Morrison passed away. And you can't, once you lose that front person with that much talent and that much charisma, you're never the same. But I always felt like Sam Andrew, The other people in Big Brother were probably like, hey, man, how come she fucking brought you? Because he was making a living. And Big Brother got left behind in San Francisco. And, you know, they just never, they never became anything else. I feel like Big Brother, though, the music she did with them, and Janice did not last very long, to have this very big catalog of, you know, regular releases. You know, there's a lot of B-sides, a lot of bootleg, that kind of stuff. But I feel like Big Brother is one of my favorite bands. Hey, before we move on to the next thing, okay. My favorite band of Janis Joplin's, I wouldn't necessarily put them in my top 10. But James Gurley, the guitar player, I love him. Going back to the Monterey Pop Festival, Janis Joplin threw a fit because they did not record her, or she made a mistake. So that ball and chain segment that you see in the documentary, that was the second performance of her set, which is great. She got her way, and God bless her for getting her way.
Yeah. I've heard that. So wait, Chris, did they play? I've heard this story and I forget. Did they play it?
No, I don't believe they played. I don't believe they played two sets. They just played that song for the film. So they did their set, and then they played that song for the film. So speaking about people that have gone way, way before their time, one guy that was voted the guy that would die before 1970, and this inspired tonight's show, mind you, Ginger Baker and John Bonham. Now, Bonham, he's an example. Okay, so Creep, so to talk a little bit about Ginger Baker first. Ginger Baker was a madman. What I would recommend first and foremost is the documentary that came out on his life, Beware of Mr. Baker. Now, when it comes to Ginger Baker and John Bonham, I gotta go with Ginger, hands down, first and foremost. Because of his diversity, he was a jazz musician. Jazz musician. To me, you have classical music, you have jazz music, and then the rest is what became from those two genres. Now, jazz really changed rock, especially in the 1960s. But when I'm watching this documentary for the second time, Ginger Baker was a shitty person. He was a shitty dad. He was a shitty businessman. He was a shitty friend, but he was a fucking hell of a drummer. The guy was a monster. I liked him more after the documentary, even though he's a total prick. There is a quote in the documentary.
I kind of liked him, Chris.
You liked him as a person, you say.
Yeah. Well, the movie opened with him cracking the documentarian in the face of the chain. He says, "I'm gonna put you in hospital."
Well, it starts with that.
I thought that guy was kind of annoying too. So you know, I was like, "Yeah, go Ginger, Team Ginger, man." You know.
Yeah, but you know, there's a quote that Santana. Now, this documentary too. You have Neil Peart. I slaughtered him left and right. Well,
I can't say it either. I know that.
Okay, so Neil, and Neil's a god. Neil's a god. He's in the documentary talking about Ginger Baker. Mickey Hart, who we love and respect, he talked about Ginger Baker. Ward, the drummer from Black Sabbath, talked about him. Red Hot Chili Peppers, Johnny Rotten. And after doing some research, the reason why Johnny Rotten was in the documentary was because Ginger Baker played drums on a Public Image Limited record.
Oh, okay. I didn't understand that either.
And lo and behold, Ginger Baker played on a Hawkwind record in 1980. I was a big Hawkwind fan, but I don't know all their catalog because they put out so many albums. But man, I got to tell you, my favorite stuff by him is when he went to Africa. Ginger Baker was a madman. He went to Africa. He started learning African drums. He started playing music with this guy's name. I'm going to butcher this name, but Fela Kuti. And man, that's what I've been listening to a lot this week. So crazy, moving stuff, timeless stuff. But Santana had a quote in there that said, Cream came to San Francisco. There's a Cream Fillmore poster there. Came to San Francisco, and they were just cosmic, and they just went balls out. Now, those guys were on a different level that John Bonham's son could play. But I saw the sons of Ginger Baker, Eric Clapton, and God, the bass player from Cream.
Jack Bruce. There's a band with the kids?
Yes, and it's named, it's a tribute band with the kids. Man, I went to the show. They were playing in time and in tune, but I could not fucking grasp it because Cream's music, have you ever seen a Cream cover band? No, because their music was so hard to duplicate, you know? And I know you're, I don't know, what are your thoughts on Ginger Baker versus John Bonham?
Oh, man. Well, the whole versus thing, this is taking me back to Circus Magazine, 1982 or something.
I hate to say versus.
Evelyn versus Kiss, I love them both. Don't make me decide. But if I have to pick, I got to go with Bonzo. Just because that's where the emotional tie is. I don't know that. Listen, I've been playing guitar for, how old am I? A Zeppelin fan before I was a Cream fan, in terms of emotional connection, I will never forget, when I started getting into Zeppelin, I'll never forget. I was at a carnival in our hometown of Northbrook, and they had one of those, spinning, it's like a swing, you get in a swing and then it goes around and around. And the carnies had the Zeppelin cranking, and it was like at night and the neon lights were going, and it was When the Levee Breaks. And there's that opening drum. Doo, 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 doo. Now, I don't know if that's difficult. I don't know if that's hard. I don't think it's like any unusual meter, but it's powerful, man. It just like, boom. And I'm watching this swing going around and na 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 na. Just I thought that was so cool. And and that's how Bonzo was. I've always loved drummers like that. I think of Bunny Carlos from Cheap Trick was like that. Just like boom, it just got you right in the gut. Jimmy Chamberlain from Smashing Pumpkins was like that. Now, are they great drummers? I don't know.
Bonzo, I
think was I definitely think for his time, that one example I gave, When the Levee Breaks. You think about the opening for that, and is it complicated? I don't know. I'm not a drummer. I couldn't tell you, but it's a groove, and it's loud and it's powerful, and that's what Bonzo was all about. And would Ginger Baker have approached that the same way? Probably not. Would Peter Criss have approached it the same way? I don't think so. And I think that Bonzo, would he have been able to play with the jazz greats? I think he was influenced by some of the same stuff that Baker was.
Well, he was influenced by Ginger Baker.
Well, he had to have been, right? Everybody who came after, 1968 or so was, but I don't think he was like making it up. Like I think Keith Moon, to a certain extent, was kind of making it up. And apparently he was friends with Ginger Baker. But, you know, he was not technically, I mean, this gets into the whole question of like, you know, are you talking about who's technically better? I mean, I feel like throughout my life, I've had so many conversations like this about guitar players, like Yngwie Malmsteen, who I mentioned earlier, was an amazing guitar player, just arpeggios, you know, just randomly, apparently. I mean, he just would throw them off and was incredibly fast and accurate. But I don't, you know, I mean, I like Yngwie Malmsteen, but I, to be honest with you, I'd rather listen to the Ramones.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, is Johnny Ramone a guitar or anything like that? But he does something, though, that not everybody can duplicate. It's, you know, it's bar chords and stuff. It's nothing, you know, but it's fast, well, and it's rhythmic, and it's
That's exactly why Led Zeppelin sold more records than Cream or any project did. Led Zeppelin sold more records than Eric Clapton did, and I think Eric Clapton is a lot better of a guitar player than Jimmy Page, but I think you have – now, going back on your question, are these good drummers? Yes. As a drummer, I'm not classically trained, but as a drummer myself, I cannot duplicate any of these guys. But I feel like the reason why I love Ginger Baker so much is because he was influenced by the genre that is just today. You put on a 1950s jazz record, it's still timeless. It's still timeless. And I feel like jazz influenced Yngwie Malmsteen. Jazz influenced, I don't think jazz influenced the Ramones by any means. But and it's funny, you talk about Led Zeppelin being nostalgic to you, for you. They're nostalgic to me, but here's the shoe that dropped. I am heavily influenced by this man here, Bill Graham.
Yes, Bill Graham.
Bill Graham, and I know you're a deadhead, and I know deadheads feel differently about Bill Graham, but I don't believe they know this true story about Bill Graham. Now, I will say that after reading this book three times, it changed my life. There is a chapter in here.
Wait a minute. Now, is this his autobiography? Did he write this?
He was writing this biography, and then he died in the helicopter crash.
Helicopter crash, yeah.
So somebody finished it for him. But this chapter, Led Zeppelin, if you read this, I don't know, Billy, because I know you're very nostalgic about Led Zeppelin. My mom had Led Zeppelin records when I was a kid. I chose Thank You, like your brother. I chose Thank You as my wedding song, but it was the Chris Cornell version. Chris Cornell from the late, great Chris Cornell from Soundgarden covered this song.
Did my brother have Thank You at his wedding?
I believe he did, yeah, because your brother, when he showed up at my wedding, he goes, "Damn you, man." He goes, you used the same song that I did. I'm 99% sure that he danced with Wendy to Thank You.
I was there. I should know. I don't remember.
But after reading, well, it was a good party, right? After reading this Led Zeppelin chapter, man, I'm going to save it for you guys to read on your own, but I recommend it. And I think once you read that book, you might have different thoughts on Led Zeppelin, but they weren't good people, just like Ginger Baker wasn't good people, but he's still.
Listen, Chris, I don't buy in any of that crap. That's one man's collection. And here's the thing, you know, you can't take everything as gospel, man. I mean, because, you know, you meet these people in real life and they're just people and it ends up not being what, you know, is written in the book. Those stories are, you know, they're stories. They represent one point in time, one person's perspective. And a very wise man once said that there are three versions of the truth. There's your truth, there's my truth, and there is the actual truth. You know, in different contexts and, you know, without the influence of drugs, which a lot of these stories are fueled by. I've heard my brother, and I think I can mention this. He's met Pete Townsend a couple of times, and Pete Townsend,
yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think he actually worked with him a little bit. I mean, he'd be able to explain this better than I, but just had, you know, glowing things to say about him. And he's, you know, Townsend's got a reputation with some people for being a bit of a jerk. But, it's funny because my brother's been in radio long enough to where it's like he's told me about enough where it's like I almost recognize a pattern where it's like a lot of times the people that have these big reputations are sometimes the nicer people, and the ones that end up being the jerks are like completely out of left field, like you wouldn't think, you know, that they were. But anyway.
Hey, you know what? You kind of hit a soft spot because after reading that chapter, that Led Zeppelin chapter, now I will tell you is that I do like the band. I don't like them, the stories that I read just in that chapter alone.
Oh.
Because Bill Graham, I feel like in a past life, Bill Graham is me, you know? But I know that's kind of crazy and philosophical, but reading his book three times had changed my life. And that's why somebody goes, if you could ask George Lucas one question, and your brother's like, nah, you wasted the question. I said, George, did you hang out at the Fillmore and talk to Bill Graham? Because it's my fantasy that George Lucas was hanging out at the Fillmore. But no, that wasn't George Lucas hanging out at the Fillmore. That was Francis Ford Coppola hanging out at the Fillmore. But going back to the Ginger Baker documentary, he says that Keith Moon and John Bonham couldn't swing a bag of shit.
Yeah. Now,
that's a pompous thing to say.
Yeah.
Keith Moon was on a different planet. He was definitely not replaceable. Another legend that was fueled by drugs and alcohol. I see a pattern here. These great musical legends.
But at least he was funny. Ginger Baker does not seem right. I mean, Keith Moon was hilarious. That's my impression of him.
All the way. Hey, speaking about people that we lost well before their time from drugs and alcohol, the last segment of the show is the band that got away. Now, the band that got away is the one band that you wish you could have seen live, or you wish you could have seen live when it could be somebody dead. Like, for example, mine was Jimi Hendrix. I really wish I could have seen Jimi Hendrix at Woodstock. I think that would have been an amazing, amazing experience, you know. But I gotta say, Jimmy, what I loved about Hendrix was just—he was like Keith Moon, but on the guitar. He was on another planet. He was in a different world, you know. My theme song of life is Voodoo Child. You know, I never even came close to having the opportunity to see this man live. And if he was still alive today, would he still be doing what he did back then? Probably not. But, you know, when somebody asked Hendrix, who is the best guitar player? He had said Rory Gallagher. Now, Rory Gallagher from Ireland, and since we just are getting rid of our St. Patrick's Day hangover, we could talk about the bands from Ireland. But
there's not many.
No, there's not many. But man, the thing about Hendrix, when he was asked who is the better guitar player, his answer, and this is your nephew's doppelganger here. Your nephew that plays guitar, he looks like Rory Gallagher. But
yeah, he does. He likes Rory Gallagher a lot too.
Hendrix replied Rory Gallagher, and man, you know, if I could have seen him live again, too much alcohol. Oddly enough, he had a song called Too Much Alcohol. But the one band that really got away from me that I almost saw, I was walking around in New York City with my wife in 2008. And I'm like, Les Paul is playing at his jazz club. I said, let's go see Les Paul. And I'm like, oh, it's fucking $50 to see him. Oh, oh man, I don't know if I want to see him, you know? I mean, Les Paul was a jazz legend. He did so much for the design of the guitar. So I'm walking around going, you know what? I'm going to pass on Les. We'll see him next time. And we ended up walking around New York in the neighborhoods. So we wasted the night. And the thing, I mean, God, the guy could fucking play. Sure. I never saw him live, but that's a great thing about YouTube, right? You can watch
it. He was the Wizard of Waukesha.
Oh, God, he was the Wizard of the guitar, man.
But no, that's right. He's from Waukesha, Wisconsin. The Wizard of Waukesha. That's what they call him.
Yes, yes. Yeah, you know, I got to go up to Waukesha and see his hometown. But, man, I gotta tell you, I really regret not seeing him live. So give me your favorite musician from Ireland.
Oh, okay.
And then tell me the band that got away from you.
Ooh, well, that second, yeah, the B question there, I wasn't prepared for. I'll have to think about that a little bit. There's so many bands, Chris. I mean, my gosh.
Yeah, right.
I don't know why Humble Pie is popping into my mind. Blue Cheer, who I mentioned earlier, I would have loved to have seen them like in their, you know, in their heyday. Yeah. My favorite band from Ireland, that's easy. Now, the runner up for that was Van Morrison.
Van Morrison, yes.
But the winner.
The winner is Thin Lizzy.
Yeah.
You know, so you and your brother are both.
That's an easy one for me. I mean, they're the band that I have loved the longest and most familiar with, and they're the rockin'est band. And yeah, I love everything about them. They're just a great band. Which, you know, it's funny, this album I showed, they were actually only half Irish at that point because they have, you know, Scott Gorham is from America and who's the other guy? Brian Robertson, the other guitar player. I think he's Scottish, but the drummer and Phil, at least, were still Irish. I mean, the whole band was Irish when they started. But, you know, the twin guitar stuff, the harmonized guitar, I just, as a guitar player, I love that. And they were one of the early bands that was doing that. Them and the Allman Brothers, of course, and Wishbone Ash, and Iron Maiden came a little bit later. But I love the dueling guitars. I just think that's the coolest, one of the cooler developments in rock over the years. But bands that I would have loved to have seen, I mean, man, Zeppelin. I mean, I can go back to that. Zeppelin, you know, circa 73. I would have loved to have seen them. I would have loved to have seen Kiss, like in the early days, you know, like in a smaller, like when they were starting out, like in a smaller club, you know, like 74 or something like that, you know, in a small New York club.
Did you see them on their reunion? Like,
I saw them when they reunited in 96. And then they, in my opinion, they stayed at the party a little too long after that. But I saw them in 96. They were still able to do it. You know what I mean? They were still young enough to pull it off. And it was incredible. I mean, I was a Kiss fan when I was a little kid. And I just had always wanted to see that. So that was a dream come true. So I mean, I guess in some ways I have seen them. I don't know if that counts, but the earlier maybe. You know, the Dead in 72 would be great. But I would just love to have been in like a fly on the wall at some of these smaller, you know, shows, seeing bands back in the 60s, even like a Simon and Garfunkel or something at one of those New York coffee houses. I would have loved that.
Now it's a one band and you're like, you went down a rabbit hole.
I went down a rabbit hole, man. It's music.
Now I really regret not seeing Kiss. I regret not seeing Les Paul more, but Kiss was kind of like my first introduction to nostalgia. You know, it went Kiss in 88. That was my first throwback to the 70s. Then it went the Muppets. Then after that, it went Star Wars. So it kind of like revisited these three things, in a very short period of time. But I saw Kiss in – Kiss was the second concert that I saw. It was this – it was the second show at the Tinley Park Music Venue in like 1991, but I never saw them with their makeup on. And it's like, I waited for that moment, but by that time, Star Wars had taken over. and I wasn't really interested in seeing that. But, hey, Billy, I got to say thank you for joining me tonight. I appreciate
you having me. It's fun, man.
Your time.
I could do 3 hours of music. So
you know what? Hey, I think what we're gonna do, man. I think what we're gonna do is I know your brother has been trying to get you to do a podcast of your own, but I think if you have the time to do it, I think we need to do a regular segment on Mocktails Live where it's Music Monday, and me and you just hash it out, man.
Sign me up for that. Yeah.
So, and I know you, before we went live, I know you asked me if these were all Fillmore posters. And I said, yes, they are all first print Fillmore posters.
Those are incredible.
It's great. You know what? I'm going to just show a quick, this goes around the room here. It's just wall to wall Fillmore posters.
That's awesome.
It got to the point where my wife said, you need to stop buying posters. And this could
what's your, what's your favorite one?
You know what my favorite one is? Well, the one that's got a story behind it is this, because I love Bill Graham so much.
Oh, Arlo.
Okay, this has got John Mayall, Arlo, and the Loading Zone, who was kind of a regular opening band at the Fillmore shows. But the reason why I love this poster so much is because Bill Graham had said it's his favorite fucking poster because he can read it. he can read the poster. Now, this is one of my favorites because I love
Joe.
I love the ocean animals. Animals of the ocean. As you will, and it's got Country Joe and Incredible String Band, who was a huge influence to Robert Plant. Huge influence to Robert Plant.
Yeah, well, they were both at Woodstock, right? I mean, you're a Woodstock scholar, you know that, right?
I don't know about a scholar, but I'm a Woodstock aficionado for sure. But the thing I love about this is the octopus is under the ocean, and you got the Golden Gate Bridge there. So he's just kind of. He's not even at the Fillmore, but he's pretty close. he's pretty close.
Phoning in, man.
I think I have a total of like 85 first print Fillmore posters.
That's amazing.
It's quite a collection. When you
Is the one behind you, is that the only one that has Blue Cheer on it, or do you have some other ones?
No, you know what? There's a Blue Cheer Icantina poster. That I have over on the wall. And I do want to comment on I don't want to comment on Ike Turner. He did bad things, but I want to comment on Tina Turner. A lot of people know her from her work in the 80s. But I got to tell you, man, the stuff that she did in the 1960s, she covered A Whole Lot of Love by Zeppelin with Ike Turner. And that version
– Oh, yeah.
No offense to Led Zeppelin, but that version – it just so much soul, man. So much soul. what I did do, I did group these posters. This whole wall is Bonnie McLean. And Bonnie McLean was the box office attendant at the Fillmore. And she ended up marrying Bill Graham, and they had kids together. So, like my Star Wars collection, man, there's a lot of stories behind these posters. Not that I'm necessarily part of, because it was before my time, but just part of music history, you know? Part of music history. I'm looking forward to having you and your brother over here so we can jam out in the Fillmore poster room.
Yeah, it'd be fun, man.
So, yeah, all right.
Bring my acoustic and yeah, we'll do some.
You know what? I want to buy a drum kit. I got hand percussion here. We're going to have a good night when that night comes. But hey, guys, thank you so much for tuning in to MACHTAILS Live, the Music Monday edition. Billy, thanks again for your time. I look forward to chatting with you about music again in the future. You guys be safe, be good. We'll catch you next time on. And don't forget, go to Patreon, become a member. Otherwise, you're going to force me to join OnlyFans. We'll see you next time on MACHTAILS from the Cantina. So long, everybody.
See you guys.